Good morning. Thank you very much for staying with us here on KTN Morning Express. My name is Akisa Wandera. We get to yet another segment, The Way It Is, where we take a look at some of the top stories that are making headlines in the country currently. And joining me in studio is Ambrose Weder, who is a lawyer, and Jarvis Bigambo, who is a political analyst. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for coming in. And thank you very much for staying with us. And I think we'll start with what's major right now and what is expected to still make big news today, and that is the Election Laws Amendment Bill. The opposition is expected to go to court today. On Wednesday, we are expecting a huge delegation to converge and try and forge a way forward to try and stop this particular amendment or the president from assenting to it. I'll start with you, Jarvis. Do you think that the opposition will be able to stop this?
Well, of course, the courts are there to do that which they're supposed to do. But I think I would like to draw our own attention to the preamble of the Constitution, especially if you look at the third last paragraph, which reads, and I quote, that recognizing the aspirations of all Kenyans to have a government based on democracy, human rights, social justice, and the rule of law. That is the aspirations of Kenyans. Those governments should be at the national and the county level. And we know very well that it is the role of Parliament to legislate. And we know very well that Parliament must legislate in such a manner that keeps within the seams of our Constitution and the rule of law itself. Now, when you look at what has happened in this country in regard to matters, electoral law reforms, then you realize that the two sides have been pulling in different directions. And while there was some discussion, deliberations earlier, that were amicable and they came to certain agreements, we recall that the National Assembly passed a bill that now came out to have this contentious issue that went to the Senate and then the position where we are at right now. With the legitimate discontent that the opposition has, it is all right for it to go to court. But question is, how expeditious will the courts handle this matter? But is it possible that this matter could possibly be settled in such a manner that does not bring about all these pre-election kind of push and pull that is only serving to raise the boiling point and the people's anxieties and emotions, etc.? Because if you look at it, if leaders at the national level are engaged in this kind of debacle, then what would you expect of their supporters you know, to entertain the such thoughts when they go into an election? So it's all right for for court to go to court, yes. But I think, as some sections of the media have reported in the past day or so, in some sections of the media, that the Jubilee has indicated their willingness to make amendments in later times. I think there is some good faith that is needed when it comes to legislation. Of course, we know very well that even the courts are not supposed to direct how Parliament is supposed to do its work. Then again, we shall depend on the wisdom of the president. When that bill will come to his table, will he amend it? And it's a question of now appealing to his consciousness about bringing and taking the nation forward. Because remember, as the laws stipulate and the supreme law of the land, the Constitution, the president is the symbol of national unity.
All right, Jarvis. Ambrose, do you think there's need for dialogue for this, just like we did with the, what was it, the special committee co-chaired by James Orengo and Kiraitu Murungi?
Yes, before I answer that, let me answer the question about people going to court today. And that is a technical question. It's a legal question. And applying my legal mind, which I have very a lot of faith in, what are they taking to court? That's the question. There is no law. Until the president signs it, it's still a bill. Do you take a bill to court? Last time they went to court, Justice Odunga told them Parliament must be allowed to go through the process, let the process complete, and then if a law is passed, bring it to us. until the president assents to the law or sends it back to parliament with the memorandum to amend, there is no law. So unless they're gerrymandering to raise public emotions and put everybody in odium that they are pro-Jubilee, there is nothing to take to court today, Monday, unless they are playing politics. They should have waited for the president to act. Otherwise, for now, it's still a bill which has been passed by the National Assembly, but it is not law. Mm-hmm. You cannot question. I hope they understand that now, the court brigade, understand that position, and go back to the latest Justice Odunga ruling on the same issue of this legislation.
Yeah.
Secondly, if you look at the texture of the coming in legislation, they have legitimate issues. I saw court brigade in Senate arguing, and they were not persuasive. They just, Honorable Wetangula was just insulting his colleagues. Orengo was so annoyed. I don't know what he smoked in Ugenya. They were not persuading others to see the point. And that is where they failed. The way the National Assembly went through this bill is what made it appear draconian and bad and ill-motivated. Duale, in his usual way, did it like, they wanted to show contempt on the opposition. They did not bring out the reason part of it, where they say, we need this kind of backup in case this fails. If you go to a polling station and your biodata are not there, the law should allow that they look at the following documents. It was a simple, straightforward, correct something.
But
he did it, yes.
You mentioned how our leaders argued both in the National Assembly and the Senate, and you say that the opposition failed to convince. But looking at how our leaders debate, especially during over contentious issues like this, most of them go with a preconceived mind based on your political affiliations.
In fact, it's not even based on... They argue from the muscles instead of arguing from the intellect with a view to persuade. They're like, I'm telling you, you're going to win this. There's nothing you can do. We are here. You are done. We have tired on your numbers. That infuriates the human spirit. When Wetangula also comes up and says, I will educate you, you didn't go to school, you didn't go to where, you have no degree. So people are just mad. They do not interrogate the real thing. The way the National Assembly went about it, especially as led by Duale, made the legislation look very bad.
Mm-hmm. But is it a bad legislation?
There are certain parts which are not good, especially the part that excludes the Senate from looking at the boundaries when they are reviewed. Mm-hmm. That is bad, and they should know it. Having a backup in case the biometrics facilities fail, that is good. But the way it has been done, you think it is just a rigging machine which has been put in place by the Jubilee to take them back to power. So I think there is need once the president assents to it, and I can assure you the president is going to assent to that law. There is need to look at that part that excludes the Senate on a boundary review. Mm-hmm. And then there is need to state that the backup is not necessarily manual, but that there are other electronic backups that will be looked into until before you reach the manual one. It is not that this one fails, manual. This one fails, look at the register. Mm-hmm. There's a way to polish it so that it looks tidy, it looks nice, and it heals the country. And that requires both sides. I think Duale should be given more camel milk so that it's sober. The opposition themselves, led by Wetangula and Honorable Raila Odinga, a good fry of fish that has been made nice with soup, so that they are calm. And then you close them in a room and tell them, Kenya is bigger than each of them.
Ambrose, do you agree that our leaders were pretty immature when it came to how they conducted themselves over this particular issue?
I think immature is not...
You can take it.
What I'm saying is that they were a bit tipsy, intoxicated by their positions. Those of us who are in Jubilee were a bit drunk. Mm-hmm. And we were like the upende usipende nasir syndrome. Mm-hmm. Yet you could have persuaded your colleagues, even if you don't persuade your colleagues in parliament because they have strong position, but you persuade the country. Mm-hmm. You come up and say, gentlemen, these things fail. Even the last elections, these things failed, mm-hmm. and therefore we went back to manual backup.
All right.
Things fail. So let us look at it. When you are in a strong position, you are persuasive. As when we are in court, you don't tell the judge, my lord, the law is very clear. Section, this is clear. You have to follow it. He will not follow it.
All right. Jarvis.
Well, I think the country has been treated to a theater of political absurdity mm-hmm. in the recent weeks with regard to the issue we are now mm-hmm. handling. And it is clear to all of us that the task of the 11th Parliament is harder, yet no less important. Mm-hmm. But the manner in which they are conducting their business, it is very interesting. To this extent, one wonders how the Senate can legislate against one of its important functions mm-hmm. by passing that bill. Because if at all, it's a question of excluding the Senate from engaging in a task that it's supposed to be concentrating on amongst its functions, mm-hmm. then one wonders where is the mind of the Senate, or where was the mind of the Senate, and why is it that they could not wholesomely look at that bill instead of all these guys training their sights only on the issues electoral, and in fact paying least attention to all other important sections of that bill. Mm-hmm. That tells you one thing, and you've raised it, and Councillor Wedda has spoken to it, that it is possible, it is true, and now it's real, that members of the August House at the National Assembly and at the Senate are of the persuasion of their political party inclination, mm-hmm. and not to the aspirations of logic, and not to the higher levels or the apex of intellect mm-hmm. that is demanded of them. Because if you look, for example, at the kind of exchanges that were taking place on the floor of the Senate, where one was flogging the other and despising the other because of the kind of high schools the other went to, or the lack of, one wonders whether it was important a consideration of what kind of primary school and high school one went to before they were voted into the Senate. Mm-hmm. Senate should concentrate on very important things. Those important things are things that are to do with their core mandate mm-hmm. and the issues that will take this country forward. But the Senate has let this country down, the National Assembly has let this country down. Mm-hmm. And now, moving forward, one wonders what is it that will be needed? Who will stand in the gap to make sure that now the wisdom that is necessary is embraced as this matter happens? It's important, for example, that the president sends this bill back. Mm-hmm. And also, it would be important moving forward, maybe the 12th Parliament, etc., that the meddling of legislative affairs by political parties and political persuasion should be something that, of course, it cannot be avoided, mm-hmm. but it's not something that should be paid attention to.
Like it is now.
Like it is now, on every piece of thing that comes to the floor of the House. The other thing is, it takes us back, for example, to an aspect of the Bill of Rights about the importance of education as a right. Mm-hmm. Now, if you look at it, when we go to election and education is not given prominence, and then you get to have individuals in the National Assembly, individuals in the County Assembly, individuals in the Senate, who do not have the kind of quality education and such kind of political acumen that would guide them to the apex of wisdom and intellect to legislate. Because when you look at the role of the legislators, if it's a question of legislation, oversight, and representation, these other two are very critical, legislation and oversight. They need brains. They need objectivity. And that's where I think Kenyans have been shortchanged. And I think it is critical then, moving forward, that also Kenyans will have to consider what kind of individuals they vote for when you go to the August elections.
Because anyway, our leaders are a reflection of just who we are.
It's very true. But you see, we have got a habit of speaking with both sides of our mouth mm-hmm. as Kenyans. One, we say that education is mandatory, but when it comes to as a necessity to having voters, leaders into office, we say education should not be a requirement, mm-hmm. at least as of now. Mm-hmm. Why is it then that we should have it as a necessity, as a right? If we were to make it mandatory that every person who seeks elective office must have, for example, a minimum degree to be a degree holder, mm-hmm. it will implore upon all families to make sure that if their kids want to have a greater future and go even into politics, mm-hmm. then they must pursue the path of education and pursue it well.
All right, Jarvis. But of course, I will argue that we've seen some leaders who are in the August House and are very learned, but you will not see a difference between them and those who are not very learned. When they get there, it's all about their political inclinations.
Well, I think those are weaknesses that are there. And by default, if some people have not gone through formal education and they've been deemed wise. Mm-hmm. But, you know, we can say that we attribute that to the mercy of the gods. But now there are those also who have gone to school. They are well-schooled, but not well-educated. They have gone to school, yes, but education has not been significant to them to the extent that it transforms how they look at every aspect of issues of life.
Right. I think, let me just add my voice on this. It's not about classroom education. So many people are highly educated here who can hardly make valid decisions in their lives and in the lives of the people of Kenya. Even if you look at the Senate, I saw people deriding Senator Mutula Kilonzo Jr., one of the most intelligent, brilliant, and eloquent young senators, as compared to his colleagues and age mates who are more highly educated, like Murkomen and Kindiki, those who are teachers at the University of Nairobi. But I would consider Mutula Kilonzo Jr. more intelligent, better, and more focused, and less of a noisemaker when it comes to serious issues. So it's not just about education. We see them. They scare people who are not highly educated. Some of us who are equally highly educated, they don't talk.
And you don't say.
Yes, and we don't say. And you look at even the legislators. They are very united and very solemn when it comes to voting for their money. They are very good, and in fact, they are united, and they say we are one country, one nation, one people when it comes to their salaries. But when it comes to serious issues, they say, oh, Raila told me, oh, Uhuru told me, oh, lies. Lies to take cover. I think the debate in the Senate was good to an extent, but people did not take independent positions. With regard to signing the bill into law,
okay,
we didn't elect a flip-flopping president. I expect and I appeal to His Excellency the President to append his signature to that bill quickly. Why do I say so? It contains issues to do with elections in August. Delaying it, he will be part of the delay. Let him sign it, let him come into force. If it is stopped by the court, the buck stops with the court. If it does not work with IEBC, the buck stops. Let nothing be in his office where they say, oh, but you passed this, but you didn't sign it for long, so we ended up not having our acts in order. He better signs it, whether it is good or bad, majority have already passed it. Court people also learn to respect majority.
All right, I would love to delve into the understanding of what this really means, but I'm told we don't have too much time, so we can go to the next topic.
Yes.
Let's talk about what has been happening for the past few days and the reactions we've gotten from leaders, of course, to do with the withdrawal of security of Mombasa County Governor Ali Hassan Joho and his Kilifi counterpart Amason Kingi, coming just 2 days after a showdown between him and the president. I think we can play that clip first before we get into that discussion on Governor Ali Hassan Joho and the president down at the coast during the launch of development projects and what was said by the State House spokesperson regarding the withdrawal of that particular security.
Tunataka tuone miradi ambayo imefanywa na Jubilee government wakati huu wa mwaka 2016. Mimi najua nikirudisha hichi kipaza sauti nitawashwa kweli kweli hapa na watu wengine. Kitu nataka nione hapa kitangazwa leo ni kwamba kuanzia sasa Jubilee government itawacha mabilioni kadhaa kwa watu wa Mombasa kwa miradi mapya.
Sitishiki na siogopi kutembea kila kona ya Kenya tukiendelea na yale ambayo tunafanya kuhusu maendeleo.
All right, that's what happened at the coast. But before we get into that, let's now see the response we got from State House spokesperson Manoah Esipisu regarding the withdrawal of their security just after that showdown.
Nafahamu kwamba usimamizi wa vikosi vya usalama umekuwa ukifanya mabadiliko hapa Mombasa na Kilifi, na nadhani ni wajibu wao kujibu maswali yoyote kuhusiana na hilo swali. La muhimu ni kwamba hakuna siasa zozote katika maswada ya shughuli za utendaji kazi na huduma ya polisi hapa nchini, ni kazi ya vikosi vyenyewe na uongozi wake kuangalia vile kudeploy watu na vifaa, na nadhani ni wajibu wao kufanya hivyo na kujibu hilo swali ikiwa limeulizwa ama ikiwa kumekuwa na pingamizi fulani juu ya yale ambayo yanatendeka.
All right, that was Manoa Esipisu when asked about the withdrawal of Mombasa County Governor Ali Hassan Joho's security and his Kilifi counterpart Amason Kingi. The opposition has termed it as intimidation. But I'll start with you, Jarvis. Do you think this is politics? And if it is political, are we stooping too low?
Well, I would look at it this way, that it is a matter that draws to or has got political and legal implications. One, that as Mr. Espisu has indicated that it's a question of restructuring, then would draw attention to Article 47, sub Article 2 of the Constitution. Mm-hmm. It's an administrative issue. Why is it then that there was no explanation prior to that and possibly a written reason to these governors indicating why it is important or this process is going to take place so that they get to understand? And the other thing is that it has got legal, political implications. Mm-hmm. One, we know very well that these are key political leaders. And also this matter happening just after an engagement at the coast, mm-hmm. where we saw a face-off between Governor Joho and the president, mm-hmm. then it's easy for one to arrive at a quick conclusion that maybe it was motivated by that. Of course, that has been dismissed. But the thing is this. Why only these two governors? Because we have got Tana River, we have got Taita Taveta. If it's a question of redeployment of security officers at the coastal region, then we should have seen that happen at the entire coastal region. Mm-hmm. But most importantly, one would have expected the grace of the security docket to inform these governors, mm-hmm. that, hey, because of the following reasons, or restructuring, we are going to redeploy certain security officers and their replacement possibly would come at point X. That has not happened. Mm-hmm. When they are left in such kind of darkness, then it is easy, by way of our human nature, mm-hmm. to read motive into that, some political motive, yeah. That could have inspired, mm-hmm. that kind of action. But of course, drawing our attention to the discussion between the president and the governor on that political podium, mm-hmm. then serious politics was at play. Remember, this was also a clash of two parties,
yeah.
a clash of the opposition as well, and a clash of government. And that is factual, and that's why when Joho was speaking, one, he was speaking as governor of Mombasa, he was speaking as a politician, he was speaking as a representative of the opposition. When the president was speaking, he was speaking as head of state and government. He was speaking as a politician. He was speaking as a member or the leader of the Jubilee Party. There is no way you can divorce all those issues. These things are fused.
All right.
And because of that, that's why you can see the hardline positions and the sentiments that came from these two leaders.
Ambrose, I don't know whether you agree with Jarvis on that.
I think I would call it political retaliation. Mm-hmm. Retaliation. Joe himself was behaving like a spoiled child, a ruffian in front of a head of state. And whereas the political space allowed him to behave like that, I think other people behind the president were like, we must do something. So they looked around what they could do and said, the only thing we can do is withdraw security, mm-hmm. which I think was also wrong because he's still a governor, he's entitled to be protected, mm-hmm. because any person can take advantage of the space, mm-hmm. and it would hurt the president more. Even this action does not hurt them, it hurts the president. And some of us in Jubilee, we feel very bad when we see our comrades in arms behaving in a way that gives the president a bad name and loses more votes. If I was near some of those people, you can twang at them, ngumi, and tell them, we are having an election in 7 months and you are behaving badly. The president trying to behave well, remain calm even when Joho is jumping and behaving and roughening up after taking Kawatungu. But now, when he has behaved, the president has behaved so well, then you go back in the room and we have withdrawn this security. We have done that, painting the president. They better stop that. And you could see even Sipisu did not have words. He was trying to look for words to say, oh, it was we reorganizing security here and there. They better stop that. Let these people have their security. Let us campaign very vigorously. Let us display the president as a president for everybody, even the Johos of this world, so that we win the next election. But otherwise, that action was wrong. It was wrong. It is still wrong as long as they remain governor.
As a legal practitioner, the Council of Governors has threatened to go to court over this issue. Do you think it will hold any water?
Oh, yes. I think the same Johos firearm license was withdrawn. It was restored by the court. If they put a case that they need that security, I think the court will still give them, and then it will be an embarrassing moment to us again. And the worst of all is the timing was wrong. Why could they even wait for 3 weeks, 1 month, and then they withdraw the security of WEDA here? Then they say, this is the process we are doing. So it's not greater than WEDA or who, that's why we have that. But you do it 3 days, people are like, wow, we told you. And Johos tends to feel, it is because I support Baba, it is because I told the president off, that's why I'm going. He's becoming a martyr, yet he's not one of those martyrs. So I think this is not tidy. Let us review our actions and get another good reason to give him that security, even if it is one ragtag AP.
But he is an elected leader.
Yes,
governor,
he's still there. Otherwise, some Al-Shabaab miscreant will pick a stone somewhere and follow him into a crowd slowly and will hit his head and they'll say, you see, Jubilee are trying to assassinate Joho. And we lose both votes.
Jarvis, what does this say about our pre-election space, just the happenings? Of course, we've talked about the electoral amendments, now withdrawal of security. It's a push and pull of the Jubilee and opposition. What does it say about the pre-election mood we are in?
Our political ground is very, very malleable. We are standing in a quagmire. And that itself is something to worry about. One would not have expected to see, at this point in time, all these, what I may, for lack perhaps of a better word, juvenile reactions to political issues on the political agora. And that itself paints a bad picture. As to the action and the intention of the Council of Governors, it is proper that they should do that in their own interest and the interest of governors and also to set precedence. But why is it that it's coming too late in the day? If you look at Article 2 of the Constitution, Article 6 of Article 2 of the Constitution, that speaks to these levels of government and the cooperation and mutuality that is supposed to be there, one should not expect this kind of thing happening at this point in time. And the Council of Governors also should have time to set bare minimums through that cooperation, that mechanism, that there is need to have these bare minimums, the respect for the governors, because these are constitutional office holders. They need not be pulled left, right, and center at the whims of perhaps those who hold various offices at the national level. So we need to have mutuality, respect, and cooperation between the national government and the county government, because now, what was a political issue initially, what the president was speaking to, what Joho was speaking to, now, right now, it is a matter that now has drawn in the Council of Governors. Now, there you're speaking about, you know, devolution. One would want to say that, could there be some intention on the part of others to frustrate the wheels of devolution from turning? You know, those are questions that may arise later, or some of the questions that may come to discussion at some point. And some will just want to cling onto that as an issue when you know, colloquiums of devolution are taking place. But of importance is that it is important for constitutional office holders to be respected. And if members of parliament have security, why should a governor's security be withdrawn? All constitutional office holders, all those people to whom security and protection is due, it must be granted to them. And it is time enough that the national government and those people in security should realize that as they do some things, as they take some action, in fact, they are bolstering the political acumen and stature of others. For example, just by the few cases or the spat between the president and Governor Joho in the past and this recent time, I can tell you this, that Governor Joho's political profile has been bolstered beyond measure.
All right.
Because now he's seen as this guy who wants to be sacrificed, but is fighting for the people, etc. and whatnot. And in fact, I can tell you this for free, that one may be forgiven to possibly come to a conclusion that it is helping Governor Joho's re-election campaign because of the building up of his political stature. Because as we know in the rules of politics, as long as you are at the center of the political storm, for good or otherwise, you are significant politically.
Any publicity is good publicity.
And that significance is what is being now granted to Joho.
All right, gentlemen. Let me pick a call. Okay.
Okay, let me just clarify something. He said something, we are in a quagmire. The Kenyan nation is very stable. It's a country that is stable. We are going. It's just a few politicians here and there making noise. Duale is making noise. Joho is making noise. Raila is making noise. That's normal. If you want to know whether you're in a quagmire, you ask yourself whether the economy responds to the politics of the country. Our country is always stable enough that it does not, even after the 2007 violence. The day the peace accord was signed, the next day everything was running like nothing had happened. So we are very, very, very stable. Get that and let Kenyans outside get that. The next one is this security, the ultimate security is our Lord God Almighty himself. So even if you put your hands in your life in the hands of one or two APs, please know that it's God who protects. And when death comes, you will go even inside Nairobi Hospital or inside Kahawa Garrison. So let them also get that. But above all, we want stability for this country.
Okay. Let's pick a call. We've, of course, gotten your views, but let's listen to what Kenyans have to say about some of the issues we've just discussed. We have a call from Onyango, who's calling us from Waithaka. Onyango, good morning. Thank you for joining us on KTN Morning Express.
Good morning. We are watching Morning Express, and we are so excited with what you guys are discussing.
Thank you.
Now, by the turn of events in the recent past, people have been getting these degrees in ways that are not okay. Mm-hmm. And this is why my suggestion would be we should not really focus on, when it comes to education, let us scrap off these things because these people, they are not even white. Mm-hmm. And about Joe's security being withdrawn, I think this is very dangerous for our country because both big parties are just fighting for this. They are trying to show their muscles, which is not really good. If people on the ground are already fighting, exchanging words, and it is a bad indication. And so in this country, we really need political goodwill from all these sides. So the courts should rise up. Our politicians should mature, and we Kenyans should be wise enough to remove all these people and bring people who have the interest of this country at heart. Mm-hmm. And I think that will really help us because we should not go back to what happened to 2007. 10 years is not a long time ago. Mm-hmm. We should try and unite this country even the more because this country has potential, and it is so sad when these politicians, yes, they are a reflection of us, but let us try and do something. It is time for us to stand and be counted.
All right.
These lawyers, Kinaweda, and these political analysts, and you, the media, all of us have the responsibility of making sure that this country heads to where, because each and every one of us has a seed of greatness in them.
Wow,
so
thank you very much.
Thank you very much for stand and be counted, all of us.
Okay. Onyango, thank you very much for speaking to us. Very sober thoughts we have there from Onyango's calling us from Waithaka. But before we get to it, let's speak another call. Margaret from Sabatia, good morning. Thank you very much for joining us. What's your contribution to the show today?
Habari yako.
Nzuri sana, habari yako.
Nzuri, habari ya mwaka mpya wageni wa studio.
Nzuri sana, ulivuka mwaka vizuri.
Mwana nilivuka vizuri sana.
Thank you very much. Unasemaje? Speak to us.
Sasa mimi ningetaka kusema hivi kwanza, neno ya kwanza. Huyu mse mwenye anaitwa Sosioni. Hawachane na mambo ya Matiangi kabisa. Kwa sababu sisi wengine watoto wetu walikuanga wanalidi kwa shule, lakini wakati ya mtihani hauna pesa ya kununulia mtoto yako result ile yenye kuibiwa. Haya, mtoto yako atarudi nyuma na unakuta ule mtoto mwenye alikuwa mwenye simu elevu ameenda mbele. Sisi tunapea Matiangi tiki aendelee, lakini mambo ya mzee baba na mambo ya Sosiani wawachane na Matiangi kabisa.
Aye.
Neno ya pili weta, nataka kuambia hivi. Mzee Joho, huyu Joho. Joho ajue namna ya kuishi na Wakenya, namna ya kuzungumuza. Sijawahi kusikia nchi yote ambayo iko na president mtu anasimama na mfanya namna Joho alikuwa akifanya president wa Kenya. Ikiwa miradi ilikuwa hapo ile ambayo hikukua imeanzishwa, baba yako akikufa awache mama yako nyumba imeanguka, hautajenga kwa sababu hii nyumba baba ndiye alianzisha. Lazima president afanyie watu wa Mombasa nini? Awafanyie maendeleo. Namna niliona mama mwenzangu mili wa viambo alitukana president mpaka tumbo yangu ikaungua sana, nikaona hili aibu. Sasa sahibu naongea mambo ya Duale, na vile mnaongea Duale aende ICC, mili wa viambo huyu na Joho hawawezi enda ICC. Hii maneno sisi tuache maneno ya kuwasha moto. Tumejua kiama itafika wakati moja, namna Mungu ataita watu. Hatutaki kiama ya pili 2017. Watu ya opposition muwe na lugha ya kuongea katika taifa la Kenya. Wacheni kuwashe moto.
Sante sana, Margaret. Thank you very much. Margaret calling us from Sabatia. Very emotional about some issues. And she's set the stage for us about the KCSE results. And I think we'll go straight. Unless you want to comment on both the callers.
Well, possibly just a sweeping comment, especially on the issue of Joho and president. Of course, our initial discussion was centered on the security issue. But when it comes to decorum, it is important for the president to be accorded his respect. You don't dress down the president.
It's an institution, after
yes.
all.
So whether you disagree with him politically or not, fact is that he is the president of Kenya. The respect due to him must be accorded to his office. And you even disagree with him with high regard to that office. So the issue of trying to dress down the president itself is not a good thing.
I would say, I said and I repeat that Joho is a spoiled child misbehaving. And I think it's due to deep-seated inferiority complex. You can't compare Joho maybe to the president, but votes have elevated him to a level where he can speak in front of a president of the Republic of Kenya. So what does he do? He becomes, in his right element, misbehaving. And you understand him in that context. I know my senior colleague, Millie Odhiambo, also being a lady and being who she is, she has in maybe her own internal storms. So when she stands up to say the president Mijinga and so on and so forth, you understand her context and you say, we are praying for your spirit so that you you heal, so that your heart heals and you become a person who has respect, who knows that this is the president of the Republic of Kenya.
All right.
And you are ready. So I think, I agree with the lady that respect should come in. And my brother Joho, please learn manners. We can have a session, then you'll know how to behave.
Well, I think we should also educate Kenyans that not everything can be taken to the ICC as well.
In fact, nothing will be taken to ICC.
But she set a stage for a very important discussion that we'll have right now on the KCSE results and the controversial comments that we've had right now. We have Wilson Sosion calling for an audit on the grading system or rationalization of the grading system as well. The opposition leader Raila Odinga also put his weight behind that. Do you think this is called for?
This is not called for. Let me start by saying this. I have the privilege of serving as BOM chairman of one of the biggest schools in this country, Jakaj Girls High School. And when these reforms came, I remember when I was talking to the Form 4 girls, and we had 500 of them. I told them, I want you to be very hopeful because all along you have been doing your exams without stealing. This time they have closed the chambers of stealing. Therefore, whatever little marks you are going to get, you are going to emerge top. This time, 60% is going to be A or A minus. Mm-hmm. So do not worry. And you will see the trend and the graph. Mm-hmm. And the schools here that have been doing very well, I'm telling you, are going to go ahead of them. And the girls believed. And we did the exams. And now the school has done very well. Why? Because those who have been stealing exams were caught unawares. They were not given enough time to reorganize, mm-hmm. to study. So they started by trying to postpone the exams by banning schools and doing that. Government was very strong, and eventually it has borne fruit. The fact is, you cannot have any exams in the world where A's and A minuses and B pluses are the only grades. The rest are few, isolated here and there. That in the integrity of such exams would not be said to be good. People like Socion should understand, you don't have to be a teacher to know what is bad. We see children, even our own children, you see them. Somebody who is average, when the exams come, he has an A. When he walks into the university and is told, now do medicine, he sits there 1 week, he runs away. Some children are outright, they tell you, we don't want those technical things. Me, I just want history and CRE put together. So you say, but you have an A, you have been qualified to do medicine or engineering. They say, daddy, forget about those ones. I am, because they know the truth. I think where we are, there could have been internal issues and there because no exam, no process is perfect. Mm-hmm. But what we have has the confidence of Kenya. It is realistic.
All right.
So Sion, please understand. My brother Mheshimiwa, my big brother and father Raila Amolo Odinga, please do not politicize this academic thing. Mm-hmm. When things were so bad, you were quiet. In fact, it became worse when mm-hmm. he was prime minister and Kibaki was president. Mm-hmm. During the coalition, that's when stealing became free fall for everybody. You buy and steal. Do not politicize this. Allow our children to have good results that they will put them in good states. Also allow your grandchildren, because I know you have grandchildren, who need results with integrity. Do not see these results and see that Matiang'i's team have run very well, Magoha's team has run very well, and therefore President Uhuru is getting credit for running government very well. And you say, no, this cannot be allowed to pass. All right. We must rubbish it. That is wrong.
All right, Ambrose, before I let you speak, Javas, yes. Let's just take a look at what Socion said before we get back to it.
You miss one single step, you mess up everything, mess up everyone. It's also creating what you call gender discrimination. You're not saying discriminate against any gender. And in fact, the award ceremony, which is critical, the backbone of the processing of exams, we look into the subject performance in terms of gender, in terms of regions, in terms of institutions. Those are facts, and they are professional processes. And if you skip it, then it's of no use even sitting for those exams. So indeed, you're asking a statistical question. That is why we have said, do a forensic audit. Forensic.
Just maybe before my brother reacts, okay. just give you 1 minute. You have heard what Socion says. The first thing he says is the ceremony where you release the results, where they are all called and they speak a lot of English, was not there properly according to them. So that is bad. Secondly, the figures were not put to them so that you know region, Kisumu County has how many A's, Machakos County has how many D's. Regional marks balancing to favor regions. He's saying that's the second flow. Mm-hmm. Three, I don't. Are those what we are talking about when you want a student who is going to do medicine to come and cut your bowels open and see whether there's disease inside? We can regionalize teachers, regionalize marks, regionalize money. But when it comes to our education, I would not even risk with my own child. If my own child, I have a student who is in the health discipline, mm-hmm. if I'm sure that his qualifications have a question mark, I cannot allow him to come near me even to cut my nail because that is risky. So Socion, negotiate salaries and abuse government and do other things. But when it comes to the integrity of results, Right. We will not allow
Let's give Jovas a chance. Jovas, you've had him. We've also had what Sosion has to say. Oh, what do you have to say?
You know, Councillor Weda has got a way of mixing comic relief with his brilliant comments. Mm-hmm. Now, there is something called education, evaluation, and management framework that should be focused on when you want to look at education system. When you look at the remarks that have been made by all those who are chastising the Ministry of Education and C.S. Matiang'i, they have not focused on the education evaluation and management framework. Now, when you look at that kind of framework, you realize one thing, that results, examination results, are not the hallmark of evaluating the competence and the ability of a student. Much as, of course, we have concentrated on examination so much in this country that we think the grade that one gets is the determinant. And in fact, we condemn some people so much just because of grading system. I would, in fact, even desire that we have a system where the examination results that one gets are complemented by other forms of assessment that make the person complete.
Yeah.
When you look at it, you realize that moving forward, we are likely to see the chorus growing even bigger and stronger, chastising C.S. Matiang'i and this education, you know, examination results. But if you were to look possibly even at the composition of those who are in the choir, then you may realize that even they could have been joined by some of the cartels who are benefiting from this stealing of examination. Mm-hmm. I am willing to turn my back on the public and lead the orchestra and look at these things very objectively. Mm-hmm. One, that it is not a must that we have an outbreak of A's and B's. Then we see that now success is ours, that students are passing. Look, you must not actually, in fact, when you do that, teachers will concentrate on drilling of pupils and students, and then also parents will be keen on the grade alone, not the whole person. If a mistake were to be done to reevaluate, or to evaluate these KCC exams, then it will also, by such standards, demand that the KCPE results be evaluated again. Now, remember that those who sat KCPE are now joining high school. So will you send them back? What will happen to them?
Yeah.
Now, the thing is this also, that it could be possible. I'm not saying that we hallow the new approach to this examination.
But it's a step.
Yes, it's a good step. The thing is this. Is it also possible that the kind of success we've been witnessing in the past has been false success, has been false excellence, where because of cheating and leakage, schools excel, but that excel is false. Excellence is false. Mm-hmm. The results are false. Because what explains, for instance, a school that had, say, over 200 A's, getting only two A's the year that follows? If at all it was a question of the brilliance of the students, the approach of teaching, then to the minimum, one would have expected 150 A's. Not a slash of 98%. So let us also be truthful. And it's important also that we try to desist from politicizing everything. It may not help us much. And if we want to look at this education issue, let us look at the education system, not the results. Because why should we train our sights on the results, the KCSE results, and not the system? If there is a problem, the problem should be focused on seeing how the system can be ameliorated and not just a question of looking at the results. Because look at it this way, and why I disagree. While moderation is also good when necessary, if people have failed, why should you say then that now because people have failed in this exam, an A will be 40 marks? 40 is just 40. So the thing is this. If people and if the results have been such that schools have not done well, the teaching perhaps was an issue, etc. Let us see that in the year ahead, how do we make sure that the results will come out and the teaching process is also so good?
All right.
But give it to C.S. Matiang'i.
Okay.
He locked out the issue of cheating and the cartels.
All right. Give it to All right, gentlemen, that, I understand we don't have too much time. Okay, 5 seconds.
Point out that if you ask the very students, the past and the present, they tell you that teacher is stealing exams. They confess, they say it with their teachers and parents, all combined. So it's not a secret. It is just that that is what was covered.
Okay.
But going forward, we also need exams where cramming does not see you through.
All right. All right. Yes. Let's just speak a call before we wrap up this segment. I understand we have Omar from Mombasa. Omar, good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm very fine. How are you? How is Mombasa?
Mombasa is cool now.
Mm-hmm.
Everything is all right.
All right. Talk to us.
Thank you for to KTN and the Morning Express and our guests today.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, first and foremost, we go to education mm-hmm. issue about Socion.
Mm-hmm.
Let Socion know that today, Kenyans of today are not those of yesterday. Wambewa Kenya wamechanganuka. What he is fighting for, he is mm-hmm. fighting for business, and we all know that his brother is in business of printing books and all that. So he's just fighting for his brother's business into our education system. So Socion, stop introducing about Matiang'i. Matiang'i is doing all his best to rectify our education system, ambayo imeharibika for so many years. Ulikuwa na hizo habari za kuiba mitihani. We know about the cartels, the business. They have turned education into pure business now. We all know that.
Okay.
So Socion should stop kuanza kuingilia na ingiana na Matiang'i. Let Matiang'i do his work.
Mm-hmm.
Now we are all backing Matiang'i.
Okay,
yes,
Omar.
Down from Mombasa. Then let's go to the security issue.
Okay, quickly, Omar.
Yeah, let me wind up mm-hmm. quickly. In fact, I would like to take a motion to the parliament,
mm-hmm.
the withdrawal of all securities from all governors, all MPs, our ratio. We have a very big deficit in the security because the international law is one policeman to 17 citizens.
Mm-hmm.
But in Kenya, it's one policeman with over 2,000 citizens. So we have a very big deficit of security. So let all politicians be scrapped of security. If they want security, they should hire their own security, not our policemen. Our police walinde wananchi, sio kuwalinda wao na wanapita wakifanya ujinga tunapotukana watu ovyo ovyo.
Okay, Omar, thank you very much for that. Quite some emotional sentiments. I would love us to discuss that, but we don't have too much time. But anyway, gentlemen, thank you very much for coming in. Ambrose Weda, lawyer, Jarvis Bigambo, a political analyst.